Hello, students, and welcome to CIS 244, Chapter 2, Project Methodologies and Processes. So we're going to just jump right into this lecture. Let's take a quick look. Go ahead and pause this. Take a look at the outcomes, you know, defining what a methodology is, describing roles. We're going to look at the PLC. We're going to look at project management, body of knowledge, PRINCE2, which is a methodology that's gained a lot of traction. We'll look at the SDLC, the software development lifecycle. Keep in mind that that same lifecycle doesn't just apply to software, it can apply to products as well. So something to keep in mind. But let's go ahead and just get started with the lecture. We got a lot of material to cover in this chapter. So when we talk about methodology, we're talking about a strategic plan, right? And you're going to hear me say this a lot. Plan, 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 plan. You know, I happen to believe in the 80-20, 70-40, 60-70 rule. And I know you're saying those don't add up, and it's because they don't. What I have found in my professional career is the more I spend time planning, the less time I actually spend on the execution, because I have a better plan in which to execute during that software development lifecycle or during a project, you know, as I'm managing a project, okay? So, you know, it's managing, it's controlling the project, you know, the game plan for implementing the project. How are we going to get done what it is the company wants us to produce? You know, how do we get to the end product? Who, what, where, when, how, and why? You're going to hear that. You're going to see that in this. Who, what, where, when, how, and why? And we'll talk about that, because sometimes a project doesn't need all of these massive project management tools and methodologies and et cetera. You find a methodology that works for you, and a lot of times you end up shortcutting the methodology. Let me be clear on what I said. Shortcutting does not mean not going through all the steps. It's just it's a smaller project. There's less risk. There's fewer people involved, you know, so the project doesn't need as much management, okay? Recommends phases, processes, tools, must be flexible and include best practices. So, you know, the idea of if this is not our first rodeo, what did we learn from the last rodeo? For those of you that don't know, you know what a rodeo is, let me use another analogy. If this isn't my first project and I've done previous projects, I need to go back and say what worked when I managed that project, you know, what people worked. Maybe I'm leveraging the same people in the same organization. Maybe I'm a dedicated project manager for company A versus a contractor. So I get to work with the same people, and I'm able to then structure the next project based on the resources that worked in the previous project. Okay. So hopefully that makes sense. You know, traditional things and then, you know, agile methods. We're going to talk about those. I want to briefly introduce you to some of these. What I'm going to suggest is that you stop and you read this. You understand that here are five methodologies for project management: Agile, Scrum, Kanban. Some of you might be familiar with Kanban in lean manufacturing, okay? The idea of a Kanban card with an inventory. Scrum Bomb, which is, you know, a combination of Scrum and Kanban, of course, and then lean. A lot of the methodologies that we use in manufacturing, that we use in production, lean manufacturing, for example, just in time, end up playing into the project plan and the project management methodologies that we use to manage the project that we're doing. Here are some more: extreme programming, you know, doing development robustly to ensure quality. With extreme programming, we could leverage programmers in different time zones so that literally we're getting 24/7 production. When we do that, though, we have to make sure we're auditing the code and make sure everything's working together as we go, okay? Waterfall is one of the original methods, you know, plan projects fully, then execute through phases. So literally, we sit down and the plan is from A to Z. That's where we're going. That's what we're doing. And then we execute the plan. Where the challenge with that today is, if we're in the software industry, we have to get our product out sooner than company B, because if they beat us to market and it's something everybody wants, they're going to jump on their product while we're still developing. Now, we may end up developing a better product, a better service, a better website, a better whatever, but we've lost a lot of the market share, and thus we lose out on the business. So consequently, today, it literally becomes, this is what we need to get done. This is what we need to get done right now. And then we'll build on that. Okay. The challenge with that is we end up with silos of data. You know, if we look at a startup business in Excel spreadsheets, the customer service department says, we need an Excel spreadsheet that does this. They start collecting data. And guess what? The marketing department could have used that information, or vice versa, right? Marketing creates a spreadsheet. They're using it. Customer service creates one, or shipping creates one. The data becomes redundant. Everybody's keeping the same data. Data gets changed in one place and not another. And that's because there wasn't a holistic approach to the project of creating that spreadsheet. And who, what, where, when, how, and why can this single asset, this Excel spreadsheet, be used? Okay. Then also, as you know, we're going to refer a lot to the PMI, the Project Management Institute, PMBOK, as it pertains to project management. A lot of great resources out there. I would highly suggest that you leverage that as an additional resource, a free resource on the web as to project management, project life cycles, etc. So, you know, sequencing, you all know about this, you know, beginning, middle, end. What is it that we're going to do? You know, the key word here is will do, right? So that actionable word, not what I want to do, but what I will do. Beginning, middle, and end. Everything has a beginning and middle and end, even making a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, right? So the beginning may be getting out all of the resources that we need, the peanut butter, the jelly, the bread. The middle might be the manufacturing, and the end might be the consumption of the peanut butter and jelly sandwich, okay? As it pertains to project management, it's a collection of logical stages or phases, and we'll look at tools later on that put a graphical representation of these phases so that we can see the project. As we know, an Excel spreadsheet is just that. It's a bunch of data. But as soon as we apply charts and graphs and stuff like that, we get a visual representation, and we do that with projects as well. So it maps the life of the project, you know, from beginning to its middle, to its end. A large project, we're going to break up to many beginnings, many middles, many ends that coincide with each other so that we can do this production maybe sequentially, one, then we can do two only when one finishes, or, you know, cooperatively where one and two and three are being worked on together, but two has to be done before we can implement four, for example. Okay, so concurrent production of different parts of a program. So we'll get into that. This is just, again, more of the basics. So to define, build, deliver the product or service. So we're not just talking about products. And keep in mind, folks, that the tools you're using here, although we're going to focus on information technology, can and should be provided and used within a business process. So even if we're not talking about technology, we can leverage these in a project that may be a new product for the business. It may be a new service. It may be even a business process. So you're going to hear me talk about this a lot. When I've had projects that have failed, it is because we didn't start with the basics. So back in the day when it was all about technology, all about computers, it was about shoving our current business process into technology and making it faster. And the problem with that, even though we had a beginning, middle, and end, was we didn't start with the beginning of the beginning, the foundation. Meaning there were problems with the business process. So what happens when we have a problematic business process and we shove it into technology? The problem becomes more apparent, faster, and a bigger negative impact. So keep in mind that we can start and should start, if we're going to automate a business process that's not automated using a project, do we have the most efficient business process before we automate? And then, of course, how are we going to automate? How are we going to bring this into information technology? Okay, so when we talk about the project life cycle, four basic areas. Now, again, you know, there's umpteen theologies on the project life cycle and how many stages there are and what happens. So, you know, define, so the plan before the plan is, you know, a lot of the who, what, where, when, how, and why. Why are we doing this project? Who is it going to affect? What is it going to deliver? Okay. So we define that, then we create the plan to get that goal done. You know, this is the goal. This is where we want to be. The goal is to have an interactive website for our customers that can order a product online. Well, that sounds great. But the question is, how do we get there? And the way we get there is plan. And again, my favorite four-letter word, plan, plan, plan. Now, can you overplan? You bet. We can spend too much time overplanning. But I'd rather overplan than underplan, because when we underplan, we start getting into change control and, you know, massive changes in the project because we didn't do our due diligence at the start. Okay, so project objectives, what are the resources, you know, what are the facilities, what's the technology, what's the human asset? That's people. People are human assets to a company. And then controls. How are we going to make sure that we're on track, that we're on time, that we're delivering what the goal was? Are we meeting the goal? Now, this is the first time you're going to hear me say this. Keep in mind that no matter what methodology you use, I'm going to encourage you to ask this question at the end of every stage. Now, this is going to seem weird, but is today the day that we stop this project? And what I mean by that is we've seen, especially with governments, we've seen projects, and I'm going to present some of those to you, where we went down this path, you know, with a $2 million project, and we're sitting at $50 million and it's not done. You know, so the question is, just because we have a goal doesn't mean we can meet a goal. We may have to wait for technology that's not available to us today. We may have to wait for people. We may have to wait for facilities. We may have to wait for resources that we don't have today, whether because we can't afford them or maybe they don't exist. So when we do that, then we plan and we go, oh, wow, this plan seems extensive. Do we have the right resources? Do we have enough budget? You know, is leadership really on board? You know, I've gotten stuck many times, even in small businesses, where it's like I'm hired as a consultant to do a project, but leadership isn't in the room. And if leadership isn't in the room, then you have a bunch of end users that are like, how important is this really to the company? And can I get my own department's needs versus the organization's needs met through this project? Okay. So again, we ask, is this the time to stop the project so we can stop the bleeding? You know, we may come back to the project. We may go back, redefine the goal, reduce the goal, build a new plan, and then execute it again, okay? Execute the project plan, you know, concentrates on design. This is where we develop. This is where we prototype. This is where we create this amazing thing that's going to meet the goal. But again, if suddenly our project timeline is off or our budget is off or we lose a key person, maybe we stop the project till we get another expert in to do that work. So again, is this the time to stop the project? And then close and evaluate. And here's the thing. So many times we stop with, we delivered the product, it's done. Whew. But we never audit. So I like to call this close and evaluate. I like to call it auditing the project. This is where we literally get with the project team and we say, this is what we delivered. This is the timeline we delivered it on. This is the budget. Where did things go right? Where did things go wrong? And then, of course, we'll talk more about this, auditing the return on investment. Because anytime we do a product or a service, the idea is that it's going to make money. It's going to make the company money. Okay. Now, understand that if we're talking about a regulatory requirement, something that we need to put in place so that we are in compliance, you might think, well, that's not going to make us money. It's going to cost us money. We have to. But the fact is, if we don't do it, we might be out of business. So you see, it really is coming back to costing us money. Okay, so we need to ask again, there are certain projects that we just have to take on. We have no control. You know, an example of right now, I'm reading the, 300-page proposal from the FAA in regards to drone identification. And I'm like, who's going to implement this? This ought to be funny. But as you know, if a drone manufacturer wants to sell a product and this gets passed, a drone manufacturer is going to have to create a system that allows drones to be identifiable uniquely. And if they don't, then they don't sell drones. So there's a great example of real life. I think that's enough for first part. We'll get to more in the next part. Take care.